Hey everybody, Steven here, and today doing an unboxing of the OcZoe A1 handheld console here. And with this, the unboxing is going to be quite simple because it's really just the handheld and then you have the charger. There's a like thank you card with it, but the manual, the user manual, is actually something where you scan a QR code and then it downloads it to your phone and you get to look at it there. So we don't even have that. But with this, the draw for me with this particular product was the slightly larger screen than the Steam Deck, and also the 6800U processor, and it still has the RDNA 2 architecture for the GPU. So with this, slightly better processor from what I can tell than the Steam Deck, but also still keeping the GPU with that. And so this runs off Windows 11. I'm going to cover a little bit of the specs, but I'm going to really save that for my full impressions video. This is very expensive, I will say that. This is $1,300. This is the pro version here. And what that has over the regular version is it has a bigger battery. This is 17,100 milliamp, and then it has the 65 watt charging, I believe, with it, versus the 48 watt with the regular version, which also has a smaller battery. This does have a turbo mode, which is cool, so you can actually change the power with this and then hopefully increase the performance as well, which I will look at that a little bit. But again, I'm not going to get heavy into everything. I do want to showcase more gameplay than anything, and I do want to note it is very hard to film yourself with the camera being like in between your legs or overhead and actually play well. So I play horrible in these videos, but hopefully it just showcases what this would look like if you were playing a little bit for everybody. So right now, watching me unpack everything, now we have the charger with this. It does have a decent cord length with it, but it's also a 100 watt charger, so it's going to have a high output battery life. From what I can tell with just like me playing for a second, it's pretty solid, but it also depends on if you're going to do the turbo mode or not and scale that to the 28 watts. With this, it has Windows 11, like I mentioned, it's the full thing. So when you go to set this up, it does take a minute because you're literally setting it up just like, and it, I've never used Windows 11. It's very similar. It's basically the same thing as Windows 10 in terms of doing the actual setup. So once you have everything set up, you are good to go, but then you need to go download things, right? So I had to go download Steam and then download my games again. I haven't messed with just taking my micro SD card out of the Steam Deck and putting it into this just to see how it would work with trying to run games off of that really quick, because that could save me some time. But in this video, I'm going to play Destiny 2, we have Halo Infinite, we have Doom Eternal, and then The Witcher 3. So just had a handful of games. It does have Wi-Fi 6, so downloading everything was pretty quick, which was awesome. And the other things that I want to look at are some of the things that the Steam Deck doesn't have, like a full USB 3.2 on the top, and then it has two USB 4, so USB Type-C. It has one on the top and then one on the bottom, which was one of the things that I wished the Steam Deck had. So you get to choose, hey, are you going to charge it from the top or the bottom? And then with that, if I'm using my Razer Barracuda X headset, and let's say I am charging it, I have the option to actually put the dongle on the bottom or the top, whichever one is free with that. So this is slightly smaller than the Steam Deck, but it has the larger screen. And with that, you get a bigger resolution. So this is 1920 by 1200. That is going to create a performance hit, though. They even have a diagram off of their Kickstarter, which is how this originally kind of started with the launch, and it's finally made it to the public here. So you could just buy this off of Amazon, which is what I did. And with that, again, you're going to have a performance hit. They kind of map that out for you. I haven't tested everything, but you can tell, like, Doom Eternal went from running pretty solid 60 FPS down to like 30s when I changed that. Now I switched the resolution over to like the 1280 by 800 and it went back up and it was pretty solid at 60. So yeah, you do have the bigger screen size and you have the higher resolution if you want to do that. But yes, you have a performance hit with that. So there's a bit of a trade-off. That's one of the first things that I notice with this. So I'm going to let the rest of this kind of roll out. The things I want to highlight before we actually switch over to just pure gameplay is going to be looking at the different things on this, the physical attributes of this. So you have the thumbsticks, obviously, and then you have a D-pad, which is smooth. So you kind of have that eight directional D-pad with this versus it being more set like you would find on the Steam Deck. You have the back button, you have the start button. So the back button is going to be on the left hand side. The start button is going to be on the right hand side. And with this, you have the XYBA buttons as well. On the bottom there, you can see the keyboard button, which is going to be the top one. And then underneath that is the turbo button. Also notice that this does have LED lights on it, and it has a very gamer aesthetic. So you're seeing all the different lines on this. So to me, it just looks like what you would find on any type of PCB, right? So it's stuff that you find on a motherboard and things like that. So the lines, kind of like cyberpunk type style is what I would think with this. You have the left and right trigger buttons on the top here. They are pretty decent, but I've noticed it's going to take me a while to get used to the grip with this because it is a little bit different than the Steam Deck, especially with the top left shoulder button there. So you got the shoulder buttons and you got the trigger button. On the bottom there, you have the home button. And then moving over now to the top, you have the power button. You have the volume up and down. You have an audio input. You have your USB Type 4 input. And then you have your regular USB input as well. And then that's the vent right there for the thermal. So it's going to exhaust heat. And if you're doing turbo mode, it does get quite loud, but you do get to tailor the fan speed and change the frequency of the RAM as well. One of the other things that I like about this though is the kickstand. I think this is really cool because it's built in and it does feel very sturdy, especially when compared to some Steam Deck cases I've used where it has a kickstand built in where they kind of feel a little flimsy. This actually feels very sturdy. I mean, I'm sure it could still break, but it feels solid. And that does help when you're going to connect a controller via Bluetooth and play on this. So I think that's a really cool feature. Moving to the bottom, you have the micro SD card slot there on the right, and then you have another USB Type 4 input on the bottom. Again, I like this. I like the top bottom options that you have with this, plus a regular USB Type A input as well. Moving on, I do want to cover really quick the turbo mode button. So when you push it, you bring up the performance metrics. And with this, the top one here, you can actually adjust the power. So you can go from the 28 to the 20, 15, 10, and 4, which is really cool. I didn't know how to change the GPU frequency and the fan speed, but I actually figured that out a little bit down the road. So I'll showcase that here in a second. You can change the vibration settings from fierce. Then you have a couple different adjustments and then all the way to just close so it won't work. And I prefer that. The vibration is okay. It's just not as good as a Steam Deck. After that, you have the RGB lighting here, and they have a ton of different options. It's really cool to see. But if you're holding on to this, you're not going to see it. Your hand actually covers the lighting there. So it's more if it's sitting there, maybe it's on the kickstand, then you would actually see the lighting. After that, you have the brightness here. So this has 350 nits, but you get to adjust that on the slider and then the volume underneath that. The brightness, though, it does get pretty bright. It doesn't get as dim as the Steam Deck, in my opinion, just based off what I've seen really, really quick. But I need to test that a little bit more. And it has 283 pixels per inch with the larger display here. Next to that, I did push the keyboard button, and you can drag that around the screen, which is really, really nice. But the image quality on this with the higher resolution, it looks really crisp. But again, it does depend on whether or not the hardware can perform with that so that you're getting 30 to 60 FPS and not something lower where it looks really choppy. So when I did figure out how to adjust the fan speed and the GPU frequency, it actually says it right there. It says press Y and then you actually get to adjust this on the slider here. So you can adjust the fan speed and then after that you can adjust the GPU frequency. Not quite sure why you would want to turn it down all the way unless you're just trying to maybe preserve some power in your paint, playing maybe like a 2D game or something like that, like Terraria, where it doesn't need that much power, but not something I would usually manually adjust. Fan speed, yes, not the GPU frequency. So this is Doom Eternal, and this is actually at the 1920 by 1200. So this is where you can kind of see, even with this game, and this is on low settings, it starts getting pretty choppy, and it was a little bit hard to play because of that. Also because the camera is literally right in front of me, I can't even see what's on screen really, so it's harder to play. But this is where you're seeing that choppiness versus when I switch it over to the, I think it's a 1280 by 800, and that there's a decent enough difference. I mean, it just plays smoother. You can immediately tell. So with this, it just depends on the game is what it seems. And this, I noticed that I made some adjustments for the fan speed, made sure it was turned on high, tweaked some stuff, and then it ran even smoother. It still would dip down into like the 40s, maybe the 30s if it was crazy busy, but it would actually hold at 60 FPS even better. So I need to spend a lot more time with this. I need to just figure out these small little quirks that this thing has, but the big draw for me was being able to play Destiny 2 without needing to stream it, like I mentioned. And for this, that's actually played pretty smooth. I've actually been really impressed with that. So for the rest of the video, I'm going to showcase the rest of the games. This again, just the unboxing video. I probably talked more than people were assuming I was going to talk, but I do want to get feedback. What do you guys want to know about this thing? What are some things that I should test? Just questions that you have about this, because I'm going to do a first impressions video, and then I'm going to do a video where I'm going to compare this to the Steam Deck and to see, when you're getting into these $1,300 handhelds, how does that stack up against one that at the highest tier is basically half the price? And is it worth going these, I mean, really, really expensive handheld routes that we're seeing now pop up? Because it just seems like in this next year, we're going to have so many, and a lot of them are very expensive like this. So let me know in the comment section. Thank you guys so much for watching, and check back. Hopefully here in the next 2 weeks, I will have the first impressions video for the AuxZoe A1 handheld.